Fionnuala Croke, thanks for having me. Frank Cunningham from MuseumViews.com, hosted by Art Info in New York, and we're here with the director of the Chester Beatty Library. Mm-hmm. And I think we'd like to start with you giving us some background on Chester Beatty himself.
Well, thank you for coming in, Frank. It's a pleasure to talk to you. Chester Beatty was an amazing person. He was a mining engineer who made great amounts of money in the early years of the 20th century, working as a consultant, and particularly in the years he worked as a consultant with the Guggenheim Exploration Company, Guggenex. Oh. He moved to London in 1912, 1913, and set up his own company there called Selection Trust. And Selection Trust went on to become a conglomerate of companies that sourced and refinanced mines all over the world.
Right.
And in fact, when it sold in the 1980s, it was bought by BP. It was the largest sale ever recorded, apparently, on the London Exchange.
Yeah.
So Beatty had this, had the independence, let's say, of private wealth to fund his collecting.
Right.
And he was always a great collector. We have stories from the time he was a child.
That's right, he started off early.
I mean, literally at the age of 10, apparently, he went to an auction house. He had his eye on a mineral sample, a piece of pink calcite, and he bid, I don't know, 10 cents or something, and none of the men in the room would outbid him because he was such a young chap. They didn't want to dampen down his enthusiasm. And then he was buying, you know, I suppose almost, one could say, typically for a collector in the early years of the 20th century, he was buying Western material, illuminated manuscripts, already buying some Persian material. Already some leaves from the Shahnameh were among his very first purchases from that part of the world. And, you know, as he established himself in London, and his collecting became ever more sophisticated. I think that's probably the best way to sum it all up. And he really ended up with what has been called the best, one of the best private collections of the 20th century. Mm. It really is the most extraordinary collection. I'm here 2 years in my post as director, and I'm constantly still learning about what we have.
Right.
And we divide the collection up curatorially into Western, the Islamic world, and East Asia.
Right.
And so we have extraordinary collections of early biblical papyrus, for example, wonderful early gospel books from all over the Christian world.
Yes, I've seen them.
Jesuit material from Asia. We have one of the best collections of Islamic manuscripts anywhere.
Worldwide.
Yes, well, so yes, indeed we have. Yeah. Yes, we've a wonderful collection of Qurans. We've over 260 partial or complete Qurans, including one of the most celebrated of all Qurans, the Ibn al-Bawab Quran, which dates to the year 1001. And then we also have about 2,600 non-Quranic Arabic manuscripts, which cover all areas from mathematics and astronomy, philosophy, you name it, all subjects that were part of the great world of learning that was happening in the Islamic world. And we have wonderful painted scrolls from Japan and China, particularly the Japanese collection is particularly important. Our Nara-ihon paintings and painted scrolls are very important.
Yes.
Significant collection of Thai manuscripts. And you know, I could go on.
I understand.
The collection is very well known to scholars who are obviously very interested in these areas and specialize in them. But we also now today, because Beatty left the collection to the Irish nation, we are now one of the national cultural institutions. Another question the question I'm most frequently asked is, how on earth did this collection end up in Ireland?
Yes.
Why did Beatty give it to Ireland? And of course, there's no one answer in that regard. He came to Ireland in 1950, which was a very significant move because he was 75 at that age.
That's
and
right.
And he literally moved lock, stock and barrel.
From England.
Yeah. He moved from England. He had been very active. He'd been very active in both wars, but in the Second World War, he was an informal advisor to Churchill. Mm-hmm. And he became good friends with Churchill, and he did a lot for the war effort, not least giving up his home for a second time as a hospital. But he also served on a number of committees, sourcing minerals and materials for necessary for munitions. And I think he was very unhappy with the Labour government that was voted in. He was a Conservative. He was very unhappy with what he saw as the unnecessary bureaucracy that came with the Labour government after the war.
So he was reluctant to leave his collection.
So to the great dismay of the larger museums, in the UK, who really at the time, I think, had probably thought
Or assumed
they might they might receive. He had he was also a very good man, very philanthropic.
He founded
a research hospital for cancer, which was called the Chester Beatty, which is now part of the Royal Marsden Hospital. And he did make a lot of gifts to the British Museum as well, and the V&A also benefited from his collections.
Before he decided to shift.
While he was in London, he became a naturalised British citizen in the 1930s. And, you know, he moved here in 1950, he'd made the decision already in 1949, and really the authorities at the time were aware that he was thinking of this move. His son had bought a house here and he'd visited a couple of times. And they were really very good, let's say they were very smart, in fact, about making it easy for him. Making it easy for him to move with this collection.
Yes.
Helping him to import new items in his collection without imposing import duties, for example. Mm. Of course, there were foreign currency restrictions everywhere after the Second World War, but he wasn't subject to them. This was a man who spent every winter between the two world wars in his house in Cairo, and after the Second World War was spending the winter in his house in Nice. So he needed access to funds, you know.
Totally.
He would go on buying trips when he was visiting Europe.
Yes.
So he came and he bought a house for himself on Aylesbury Road, which you'll know. I always say Aylesbury and Shrewsbury are the two best roads on the Monopoly board. And he bought a house in Aylesbury, and around the corner he bought a site in Shrewsbury where he built his private library. And when he came, he brought his librarian, his bookbinder, his book manager and his publisher.
They all moved.
They all
lock
came
stock.
Yeah.
It was such a great gift to Ireland.
It really is the most extraordinary gift.
Did they realise it at the time?
Yes, they did.
Which is brilliant.
Yes, in fairness, they did. He made a gift of paintings to the National Gallery. That was the first thing he ever gave to an Irish institution. He donated to the Irish nation a gift of 19th century paintings.
Is that the ones that are on exhibition?
Some of them are on view downstairs.
Yeah, I was curious when it said in the brochure they were from the National Gallery. I thought everything had come here.
No, and I think it's very interesting because when I was putting together that display that's downstairs now of some of the paintings from the gallery, it really dawned on me because he went on to gift lots of miniatures and more paintings to the gallery, hundreds of items, in fact, to the National Gallery over the following decades after he moved here. His concern was that his private library, and that, of course, must have been the core of his collection for him.
Yeah, the nucleus.
That was what really his heart and soul had gone into over the years.
His life's
passion.
Yes.
And really quality and rarity were the key words.
Yeah.
And he took the best advice and he was prepared to pay a decent price for the best, rarest piece available. And constantly throughout his life, he sold works, if they were sort of B works, if anyone came along.
He knew how to enhance and how to strengthen his collection where it need be by selling an oversupply of aspects.
He was an extraordinary collector.
So
I think it's very clear, you know, that, I mean, they had wonderful furniture in their home in London. They had wonderful decorative art objects.
Yes.
They had paintings, as I say. They had lots of collections, if you like.
So he was a monumental man.
But it was his love of the book, his love of writing, the history of writing from the very beginning in all its manifestations throughout, let's say, the Western and the Asian world. That really was at the very core, and that's what is housed here in the Chester Beatty Library.
Isn't Ireland lucky?
We're extremely fortunate. Yeah. He didn't endow the library. That's the only part that was a little difficult for us.
And was that from he just never thought of it, or
he did think about it, and he spoke about it a little bit. He decided he was going to model the Chester Beatty Library and the gifting of it on Pierpoint Morgan and what had happened with the Morgan.
With the library.
And you know, there are a couple of phrases attributed to him. One doesn't know how true they are, but that, you know, just because you give somebody a racehorse, you don't give them with the feed for the rest of their life. I think he felt he'd come to a very reasonable and a very generous agreement with the Irish government that he would leave the collection to the Irish nation and they would undertake to care for it,
And
to keep it in posterity.
And he obviously knew that as time went by, the collection would become of such interest to so many that it would bring a sufficient crowd to come and look to support it. But you tell me now that there's no charge to come visit?
No, like all the national cultural institutions in Ireland, admission is free.
You don't have a suggested donation?
We have donation boxes sprinkled around the building.
I know.
But we are financed through a grant in aid from the Department of Arts.
Which can fluctuate,
and obviously, few haven't heard of the economic woes
Absolutely.
Of Ireland in the last 4 or 5 years, and of course the arts have been impacted on significantly, as has every other sector in Ireland. So we keep the best foot forward.
And you have a benefactors circle, and
we have a benefactors circle. We kind of, the grant and aid from government keeps us ticking over, let's say. Pays the bills.
Yes.
But by and large, but any special projects, we source private funding.
You reach out.
We apply to foundations. So, for example, we had
a lot of work.
It's a lot of work,
And time it takes. So then you haven't time to really look at the collection in its totality.
Well, you know, you're constantly trying to balance everything.
Yeah.
You're trying to balance the research side of operations, which keeps the collection alive and keeps it relevant. You're trying to develop the learning and educational aspect.
Preservation.
And you know, here in Ireland, and this is something if I can modestly say I'm very proud of with the Chester Beatty, is that we are the one institution in Ireland that has really diversity at the heart of its mission. Ireland has changed.
Yes.
The population has changed. The face of Ireland has changed significantly in the last decade or two with these very welcome migrations of people into Ireland from all parts of the world.
Mm-hmm.
And so we see ourselves really as a very natural home for those kind of conversations about, let's say, intercultural dialogue. We partner every year on Chinese New Year. We host a Thai Family Day on their national day every year.
Oh.
We have hosted conferences on understanding Islam. We reach out to all communities as they're reflected here. And they do, and they, in turn, we find ourselves sort of as kind of a locus, let's say, for groups and charities and foundations to use our space.
Which, getting back to the funding aspect and the fact that, you know, in most countries, when the economy is down, insufficient funds go to the arts and cultural institutions.
Yes.
But it reminds me that another great collector, Dr. Albert Combe Barnes in Philadelphia, the Barnes Foundation, that he endowed it, but he put all his shares in railway stock.
Oh.
So the Barnes ended up with very little.
For example, one of our great supporters, for example, is the Sumitomo Foundation, Japanese-based. And they're wonderful because now we're on a second project of conservation, because to restore the Japanese scrolls is a very specialist business.
Yes.
So with something like that we need to outsource, that's been a great source of funding.
I was thinking that with your foreign collection, that to attract them to come and partnership.
That's right.
And do you allow pieces to travel?
We lend works as best as we can to let's say to scholarly exhibitions at sister institutions around the world.
Oh, that's nice.
Particularly, we find the Islamic material is often the best known and the most requested. We would lend a lot to the States. We had we had works in the Gifts of the Sultan exhibition in the LA County Museum of Art, which went on to Houston and on to the Museum of Islamic Art in Doha, was the third venue.
All right.
We're lending to the big yoga exhibition in the Feuersackler Gallery. We lend to a lot of exhibitions.
That's great.
As best we can.
Yeah.
Well, it's very important. You know, it's important to be connected in the museum world. There's no point in being isolated. Those professional networks are really the lifeblood for the museum, and to keep staff connected and motivated as well.
Yeah, and to realise you're not alone.
We all share the same problems, actually.
Funding,
we really do.
Funding and
preservation. You talk to museum director
Yes,
anywhere. Everyone. They'll come up with similar problems. Yeah.
That's great. And thank you very much. And for my viewers.
It's a great pleasure.
And I look forward to going around the
Thank you. Thank you very much.